Hi, Ben Constable with you from Sparx Systems. Today I want to help you data modelers and database engineers solve some common challenges in designing and maintaining relational databases. First, I'll show you how to model useful database concepts including foreign keys and SQL views. Here's the example database schema I'll use. The example has two tables related by this foreign key, and it has an SQL view to facilitate queries. Next, you might wonder, how do I generate DDL scripts for my database design? And how do I ensure those generated scripts match my coding standards? That's the second topic I'll discuss. And do you sometimes have to analyze legacy databases with a view to updating or redesigning them? How can you effectively visualize existing database schemas and communicate design issues with other team members? Well, in the final part of our session today, I'll demonstrate how to reverse engineer designs from a live database. Now, how do you create that database design in the first place? As shown in our previous database engineering webinar, Enterprise Architect includes a database-centric view that helps you model new databases and connect to, query, and synchronize with existing databases. We call it the Database Builder, and I'm revisiting that today. But how does this tool really help you? Well, the Database Builder provides an interface that visually represents the relational database concepts. So tables, views, and stored procedures are grouped together with specific tools available to help you create and manage them. As you create your design, the Database Builder automatically models each concept using UML, an industry standard modeling notation. So you can easily produce useful diagrams and reports that help you communicate your design effectively. Now let's rebuild that example model I showed at the start. To begin with, we already have the two tables we modeled in the previous webinar, customer and account. Now I want a foreign key between these tables so that given an account ID, I can find out which customer owns that account. So it's a one-to-many relationship. Well, how do you model a foreign key? First, open the Database Builder from the Tools menu. Notice the list of database models? Each item here corresponds to a data model in EA's project browser. See, right here is the diagram I just showed you. By loading one of these items, I'll get a categorized, editable view of that data model. And today, my example model targets the MySQL DBMS. Now I load that model by right-clicking it and choosing Load. So here are my tables. And you may remember you can easily add and remove tables from the context menu. Just like so. Looking at our account table, what do we need to define our foreign key that refers to the customer table? Well, we're missing a column that holds the customer primary key. You can see it here already in the customer table. Well, let's add it now to the account table. To do that, make a new column just by typing in a name for it. Customer ID will do. Then choose a compatible type for it, namely int. And here you might choose not null, effectively forcing accounts to have a corresponding customer. So now we have a place to hold the reference to customer ID. How do we link the two tables via this column? Simply right-click the table where we want the foreign key and choose Add New Foreign Key. I'm prompted to select the parent or reference table. In this case, the customer table holds the reference. Now we can set the foreign key details. As shown in the dialog, the foreign key is based on customer's primary key. Notice that the parent table is listed as customer, and account is the child table. EA takes a good guess as to what columns are involved in the primary key constraint, based on the column names and types. Of course, you could override that for the child table using the drop list here. Notice the other foreign key details I can adjust. I can override the auto-generated default name here and set the action on delete and update. For example, I don't want any customer rows being deleted if there are still existing accounts linked to them, so I keep the restrict setting here. And as for updates, I want changes to the customer ID to cascade to the accounts table, so I choose the value cascade. Also note we have a one to many relationship, and EA will create an index for it. Here's the foreign key now represented in the database builder. Just double click to edit it again, like so. And here it is automatically inserted into our UML diagram. It's a specialized UML association with a corresponding class operation. Now you could use a diagram first approach to creating foreign keys by creating a UML association line between the tables and then set the foreign key details. Now how can EA help you to implement this design change in the database itself? There are a few ways, but a simple approach is to show the differences between our model and the connected database using the database builder. So right-click at the top level and then show differences. Now we want to synchronize from the model to the database. Notice EA wants to create a new customer ID column in the accounts table and add a foreign key. Well, that's all good, so generate the DDL to the execution engine. And here are the DDL statements that will be run. Scrolling through them, they look all right. So execute all, and we're done. But would you like to verify that the change actually made it into the database schema? Simple. Run an SQL query to do that right from within EA in this SQL scratchpad. Just look at the create statement returned by the database. Here's the customer ID column, and here's the foreign key detail. Let's consider SQL views briefly. You can easily model views from the database builder here. Just right-click to add one. Say I want to view columns from both the customer and account tables to get customer account balances, so name the view accordingly. And to define the view, just put the entire SQL query into the definition field, including the create view keyword. Now in UML terms, an SQL view is modeled as a stereotyped class. You can document the dependent tables using dependency connectors. And these links will then show up in the SQL properties. Once you've generated your view and implemented it in the database, you can use your views directly from within EA. Let's see some examples. From the database builder, I'll first seed my live database by inserting some data. I have a query to insert customers, and another to give them some accounts, and this query exercises our view generated by EA. Notice the four fields I'm selecting, they're really from the account and customer tables, but have been effectively grouped by this SQL view. Running the query, we can see our view works quite well, and shows customers with outstanding balances, some with multiple accounts. Now, do you always have the authority to update your design and immediately send DDL alter statements straight to a live database? Some governance rules might require that you pass a DDL script to your database administrator, then he or she will execute the script on your behalf. Furthermore, there might be rules about how your DDL is formatted for readability, coding standards, and so forth. Suppose, for example, every one of your DDL scripts needs to contain a comment section at the top containing specific information about the relevant project or application. Would you then have to manually post-process each script that EA automatically generates? Not at all. Let me introduce you to EA's Code Templates for Database Engineering. As you may know, all of EA's DDL generation is now template-based, so you can modify the way EA generates code to suit your needs. Let's get started by modifying the header comments that are generated for each DDL script. You access EA's Code Templates from the Package menu, Database Engineering, Edit DDL Templates. In the Language field, you can choose the DBMS for which you want custom templates. I'm choosing MySQL for this example. Next, we see a list of templates that generate specific parts of the DDL script. Most of these directly correspond to a model construct as well, so you have a good idea of where to look to modify a particular aspect of the generated DDL. For the header comments, we're interested in the top-level file templates. Clicking on the file template, we see the first thing that gets called is the header template, so that's where our edits need to go. Let's open that one up. The template first checks whether the comments option is turned on and aborts this template if not. The processing instruction, that tells EA to end each non-empty line in the template with a new line in the generated script. And these variables define the start and end tokens for a comment in DDL. So we want to place some notes in here. Let's say I need to specify the project name first. Here I've told EA to write out the value of the start token first, and then a couple of spaces, and then I've hard-coded my project name. Note that any characters you type into the template will be output as literal characters, unless they are marked as a variable using the dollar sign, or part of a macro which is contained within these percent markers. While I'm here, I also want to hard-code the DBMS type so it writes MySQL with my preferred capitalization. Would you like to see a more detailed update to the templates? A user recently asked about modifying code for column definitions. Specifically, can you suppress the null keyword that EA generates for MySQL nullable columns? Whereas MySQL gives you the option, most DBMSs don't accept the null keyword in a column definition. It's assumed unless you specify not null. So what if your DBA demands that you stop cluttering your MySQL DDL scripts with the null keyword at the end of every nullable column? Could you accommodate a request like that? Yes, you could. Head to the column definition template and notice from line 29 it deals with nullable columns. Now, prior to EA having template-based DDL generation, you had a specific GUI option just to suppress the null keyword for MySQL. With templates, this option became redundant, so it was removed. So this if clause actually has no effect. It always evaluates to true, and so always writes null for nullable columns. So we'll be releasing an updated version of this template to remove that if clause, which I'll just do for now. Now, how do you suppress the null keyword? We simply change this outer if condition to only handle non-nullable columns, so change that equals true to not equal, and remove that first part of the condition. Then only the not null syntax is going to be considered down there at line 45. So let's save our change and regenerate the DDL for our database schema. Back in the database builder, right-click the data model and choose Generate DDL. We want to generate a script to file to give it to the DBA. Therefore, select the Generate Single File option. But to show you how EA normally generates the DDL, I'll view the previously generated script. Notice the null keyword appears for every nullable column. What happens when we regenerate this script with our new templates? null no longer appears for nullable columns. And see our custom comments in the header now? These are the only two differences of note, so hopefully our DBA is happy now. Let's now focus on reverse engineering, which is useful when you need to analyze or document schemas of existing databases. Assume our sales database does not yet have any formal design. Let's reverse engineer its schema from the live database. To start, I recommend creating a placeholder for your imported model in EA's project browser using a model pattern. This will ensure the schema is sorted into logical sub-packages for tables, procedures, views, and so on. It will also allow the model to be inspected and edited using the database builder, because you'll have a package that's stereotyped as data model. First, select an appropriate place in the project browser. Click the model pattern icon. Choose the database technology. Finally, select the type of DBMS you're targeting and click OK. Now you have the package structure in place, and you can rename those top-level packages if you like. So how do we kick off the import process? Right-click the database package and choose Code Engineering, Import Db Schema from Odbc. First, we're prompted for the source database, which I've specified using a DSN file. Next, note where in the model the imported schema will go. This is the package I selected in the project browser. You have various options as to what to include, for example, views and triggers. And some constructs, such as stored procedures, you can import either as one per class or group them into a single element with each procedure represented as a UML operation. If you have an existing data model, you can automatically synchronize it now with the database. In this case, I'm importing the tables as new. So click Import. I'm prompted to enter a password to connect to the database. Now here I can select which parts of the schema I'm going to import. For this small example, I'll just take everything. Now what does the imported model include? Here's the UML diagram, and it's basically the same as my original example. It needs a little bit of a tidy up, so I'll drag these elements and make them the same size. And you'll likely have a bigger imported model, so you can leverage EA's layout tools to help automate this tidy up. Auto route is good for neatening up your connectors quickly. Returning to the database builder, we can see the same model hierarchy represented here, so our foreign key relationship is in place. Our view is defined as well. So we have a proper design model in place. We can easily generate reports and communicate this legacy schema to other team members now. We also now have a base from which to update the schema. So today I've shown you some more of EA's powerful database engineering capabilities. I used MySQL for the sake of an example, but you can apply the same tools to your DBMS of choice. To recap briefly, the database builder helps you compose relational database concepts in an intuitive view. You can also instantiate your schema in a live connected database and execute queries. EA's code engineering tools for DDL are based on templates. This means you aren't locked into the style of auto-generated DDL that comes out of the box. Using the templates, you can tailor the DDL to suit your project's coding standards. You can also visualize existing or legacy database schemas quickly by using EA's database import capability. This helps you understand the structure of the schema, communicate the reverse engineered design to colleagues, and gain traceability from the legacy data model to other enterprise models. Well, that's it for now. Until next time, happy modeling!